Hello everyone. Thanks to everyone for watching this video. My name is Qi Dao. I am an architect and engineer. Today's video is titled Reinforced Retaining Wall, and it is going to provide you a conventional analysis and also a numerical analysis. I am going to give you an overview of what I am covering in today's video. First at all, it is a bit of background to the topic, and then focus on the conventional analysis and the numerical analysis before wrapping up with conclusions. Reinforced soil, just like rebar in concrete. You can create a strong composite material with soil just by adding reinforcing elements. A wall created in this way is called mechanically stabilized earth. Here is a quick demonstration of how this works. Without any reinforcement, the wet sand can stand up vertically, but as soon as you apply a load, you get failure. Even just a few discs to reinforce the soil allows the sand to hold up this weight. So, what's happening here? The tension in the reinforcement is generating confining pressure in the soil. This pressure acts perpendicularly to the failure planes, increasing the shear strength of the sand. Building on reinforced retaining wall in real life works exactly the same way, and they primarily use in highway projects, especially on the approaches to elevated roadways. Compacted soil is added in layers with reinforcing elements in between each layer. Most reinforced retaining walls have a facing of interlocked concrete panels, usually with some kind of decorative pattern, and these facing systems are what make them so recognizable. So, how strong is a reinforced retaining wall? The simple answer is stronger than you would think. With a little bit of reinforcement, we've transformed this dirty propensity into a simple, inexpensive construction material that you probably drive over every day. This is probably on the order of 270 kilograms, and you can barely even see movement as the weight of the car is transferred to the cube. If we dropped a 25-pound barbell from about 1.8 meters up to simulate what would happen, almost no damage. In fact, if a person had a facing system to keep the edges intact, you probably wouldn't have known the difference. Now we know soil reinforcement works primarily by adding the tensile strength to the soil, or what we want, by transmitting load from one part of the soil body to another. Now, in terms of the analytical approach to modeling reinforcement, we look at standard textbook and design codes. There is a general consensus on the principles of modeling reinforcement. So, either the reinforcement pulls out of the soil. If we have a sliding wedge along the boundary, that wedge to slide. But if the wedge slips down, the reinforcement would pull out of the wedge. Essentially, the relative interaction is the same. It would be modeled in a general way. If we are looking at a wedge type of analysis, for example, sliding of that plan, then essentially, we do a classic sort of Coulomb wedge calculation, but include additional forces acting along each line of a reinforcement equivalent to the pullout of forces is available in that reinforced position. So, determining these product forces is one key element in the analysis, and the normal approach that is taken is that through an undrained soil. It is assumed that the shear stress at failure of the reinforcement boundary is equal to some factor alpha multiplied by the undrained shear strength. But after that even factor, and if we are working with two-dimensional reinforcement of length L, then the pullout force per unit width into the diagram is 2 alpha. See you out on the Zhibrin in the Shia on the top and the bottom of the reinforcement. For a frictional soil with strained soil typically, it is assumed that the shear stress at failure or the bungee is the normal stress multiplied again by adhesion factor alpha multiplied by 10 phi, where phi is the friction of the surrounding soil. So again, the pull-out force is going to be given by this equation 2 alpha sigma n 10 phi to cover the friction at the top and bottom of the reinforcement. Now, in hand calculations of horizontal reinforcement, the average normal stress is typically taken as a way to overburden the depth per unit area. It doesn't look a lot really stress changes in the soil mass that are due to sliding failure. So, an idealization in that type in conventional analysis. So, we will look at how this type of modeling concept is applied in the discontinuity layout optimization. The discontinuity layout optimization upper bound limit analysis can be used to simulate the geotechnical problems. Here, we call the method DLO. We will just recap quickly in here that works. If we have a domain that a rectangular block of soil with a load on it, and fix the boundaries to the left into the base. What we do is we populate the domain nodes. We've got an array of 4x3, 12 nodes. In principle, we collect every node to every other node with a potential slip line. Then you utilize optimization to pick out of that set of potential slip lines. The critical mechanism that dissipates the least energy, but that gives us our critical collapse mechanism. So, for 12 nodes, we have 12 times the level over 266 possible slip lines using optimization. We pull out the 6 critical slip lines that form the collapse mechanism. The more nodes we use the solution, typically we run the code be running with 500, 1000, 2000, or more nodes, millions of potential slip lines to be modeled. So, in the context of reinforcement soil in interaction, adopting this approach, we can capture several different modes of that type of interaction. Looking at its diagram, we've got another analysis, it's so excessive soil sliding around the reinforcement. We can see the reinforcement in the picture being pulled out of the soil. That's modeling sort of classically reinforcement pull out. We have differential movement between the soil of the reinforcement along the length. It also captured correctly and further down. You can see that the reinforcement is staying embedded in the soil behind the wedge. But here it's being pulled out and we allow it to pull out of the wall element in this case, just to illustrate that point more clearly. It is easy to know the bearing capacity of reinforced retaining wall is better than normal retaining wall. From conclusions, what we learned? The modeling of reinforcement in DLO uses the same mechanics as conventional methods such as the two-wedge method. But effectively, we can model thousands of wedges and complicated interaction between the reinforcement and the element. But we are capturing all our conventional assumptions of that type of interaction in such a general way that there is no need to separately consider internal or external failure or pull-out lengths or reinforcement rupture. They are all inherently captured within the model, and as you've seen, the general principles are two works. It searches essentially all possible failure modes that are defined by that little pattern interconnecting potential slip lines in the problem. Okay, thanks to everyone for watching my video today, and I do hope you found the video informative and that you learned some things from it. If you do have any questions, then you can write comments and messages. I am happy to answer any questions. Thanks for your watching.